The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. I am so glad that we're able to worship God together. Actually, today is the first Sunday in September. Are there any birthdays or anniversaries that we would like to celebrate? Some, mine. Today is Brian's. Happy birthday, Brian. On behalf of the congregation, I wish you God's richest blessing as you celebrate these milestones. There are some announcements in the bulletin that I'd like to mention. Exploring the Word Bible Study is beginning a week this Wednesday, and you are welcome. You want to try it out for a couple of weeks, please come. It's a wonderful way to prepare for the service because we study the text on which I will be preaching. The Book of the Month Bible Reading Group and Study is reading Jeremiah during September. Next Monday is the deadline for newsletter subscriptions. The Ladies' Evening Fellowship meets this Tuesday at 1:30. You are all welcome. All women are welcome. And finally, the last time I was here, we marked the 75th anniversary of Presbyterian World Service and Development. And they have produced a beautiful book called Practical Compassion. So it's out there as you come in the door, and I invite you to take a look at it. It's a wonderful celebration of what God has done through that ministry. So let's prepare for worship with a few moments of silence. Let's pray. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Please join me in the call to worship. Joy comes to those who follow the ways of the Lord.
You will follow the Lord with joyful hearts.
Those who follow the Lord are like trees planted by the river, bearing fruit each season. Worship the Lord who leads us to joy and abundance. Let's stand and sing to God's praise. Come, thou almighty King. Creation, You have opened the world around us and filled it with creatures of your love and purpose. Each one declares your praise. The mountains state your majesty, the ripened field your generosity. Birds flying aloft sing of your freedom, the tiny ant works with your persistence. And what do we declare about you in our lives? We pray that our work will honor your justice and mercy. May our relationships speak of your love and compassion. So may we praise you, O God, not just in this hour of worship, but in all our waking and our working. Challenge us today to live out the praise we offer you through the grace of Jesus Christ and the guidance of the Holy Spirit. God of justice and mercy, we offer you our love and loyalty in worship, yet we admit we do not live out that love and loyalty. We don't always act on our good intentions. We fail to keep our promises. We hurt each other and then refuse to seek or offer forgiveness. People must look at us and wonder if this is what it means to follow Jesus. Forgive us. Help us to live as your beloved children. Amen. From now on, St. Paul declares, we are to regard no one from a human perspective. If anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. The old has passed away. See, everything has become new. Thanks be to God that we can make a fresh start this day. Amen. Let's stand and sing to God two songs, Psalm 103, followed by All the Lord Has Done. Please stand.
My soul will sing with all the strength I have in me. I will rejoice with every day he gives. I will recall the wonders he has shown to me. His power to heal, his mercy to forgive. We join with angels to sing his praises. He does not treat us as our sins deserve. High as the heavens reach above the earth is your unfailing love, is your unfailing love. Far as the east is banished from the west, you took our sins from us, removed our sins from us. How wide, how high is your unfailing love. Our King delights to show compassion to the weak. Their deepest needs he loves to satisfy. Throughout the earth justice and his mercy speak, and he will run to meet the victim's cry. From everlasting to everlasting, our youth renewed with every step we take. High as the heavens reach above the earth, yours your unfailing love is your unfailing love. The east is banished from the west. You took our sins from us, removed our sins from us. How wide, how high is your unfailing love? Though we are dust, a moment in eternity, as flowers bloom today and they are gone, he crowns our lives with beauty and with dignity. His patience smiles on all who turn on him. From generation to generation, we'll tell the story of his faithfulness. unfailing love is your unfailing love. Far as the east is banished from the west, you took our sins from us, removed our sins from us. How wide, how high is your unfailing
you to think of the many gifts that God has put in this congregation. Some gifts are really obvious. We just saw it now with Nathan, how he seamlessly switched from one song to the other and changes chords. Nathan's gift in music is a gift to us, and there are others in our congregation who also offer the gift of music. We have teachers who help us understand God's word. Some people are really good listeners. They know just how to be there with someone. They know when someone needs a friend. And some people have lots of energy, and they are filled with ideas of what God might be calling us to do. Some people decorate our sanctuary so that it helps us remember God's beauty. Today, we are talking about the gifts of the Spirit. So in your worship art today, I would like you to draw a big gift box. And in that box, I want you to write the gifts that God has given you. There is no Christian filled with the Holy Spirit who has not been given gifts. Write these gifts in this box and keep it where you can see it over the week. I'd like you to add more, because they will come to your mind, that God will reveal to you more of the gifts that he has given you. Now today we're going to use a body prayer using our hands. So you have to watch me so that you know what to do. But let's pray together about the gifts of the Spirit. And first I want you to make a cup, a gesture of receiving. It's as if you have water in your hands. Let's pray together. Dear God, we recognize the gifts that you have given us. And now I'd like you to lift up your hands to God with your cupped hands. Thank you, dear God, for all the gifts that you have given our church. We thank you for the people who fix things that break. We thank you for the people who phone and write us when we are discouraged. We thank you for the people who organize our congregation so that things get done. We thank you for those who reach out to others who don't know you yet. These are wonderful gifts that help us to live as your people. Raise your hands further. Dear God, we promise to use these gifts to love and to take care of others. Finally, fold your hands. Help us to use these gifts wisely and lovingly. Amen. Let's approach God's word with prayer. Let's pray. God of truth and wisdom, send us your Holy Spirit as we listen to your word. Refresh our understanding and equip us to respond to you in love. For the sake of Christ our Lord. Amen. Our responsive psalm is verses 5 to 10 of Psalm 36. Your love, Lord, reaches to the heavens, your faithfulness to the skies. You, Lord, preserve both people and animals.
How priceless is your unfailing love, O God.
People take refuge in the shadow of your wings.
They feast on the abundance of your house.
You give them drink from your river of delights.
For with you is the fountain of life. In your light we see light.
Continue your love to those who know you, your righteousness to the upright in heart.
Good morning. Today we are reading Corinthians 1, number 12, 1 to 11. And this is Paul speaking to the Corinthian Christians in their church. Now about the gifts of the Spirit, brothers and sisters, I do not want you to be uninformed. You know that when you were pagans, somehow or other, you were influenced and led astray to mute idols. Therefore, I want you to know that no one who is speaking by the Spirit of God says, Jesus be cursed, and no one can say, Jesus is Lord, except by the Holy Spirit. There are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit distributes them. There are different kinds of service, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of working, but in all of them and in everyone, it is the same God at work. Now to each one, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. To one, there is given through the Spirit a message of wisdom. To another, a message of knowledge by means of the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by that one Spirit. To another, miraculous powers, to another, prophecy, to another, distinguishing between spirits, to another, speaking in different kinds of tongues, and to still another, the interpretation of tongues. All these are the work of one of the same Spirit, and he distributes them to each one, just as he determines. This is the word of the Lord.
What I'm about to say, I do so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I once knew a man whose hobby was stained glass. His work was beautiful. He made all sorts of things. It's his Alpha and Omega, which still stands outside the front doors of his church. One of his projects was a stained glass kaleidoscope. And so when you gently turn those rings of the kaleidoscope, it revealed stunning, colorful, ever-varying array. It was truly a pleasure to use that kaleidoscope, each color so vibrant, so clear, an unending variety of patterns. A kaleidoscope is a good image for the Church of Jesus Christ, beautiful and vibrant, with an unending variety of gifts, ministries, and activities. We are a beautiful kaleidoscope, blessed with the gifts of our generous God. Now, the Christians in Corinth did not feel beautiful, nor did they feel blessed. Paul is writing to a deeply divided congregation. Our passage begins, "Now concerning," which lets us know that Paul is replying to an earlier letter. The church in Corinth had written him a list of their problems, and he has been working his way through them. They argued about which preacher was better. They didn't agree on how to address open sexual immorality in the congregation. They were taking each other to court over unresolved issues, and they couldn't agree about the proper exercise of Christian freedom. That issue included marriage, food offered to idols, worship practices, the celebration of the Lord's Supper, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. They fought about nearly every aspect of church life. And Paul just kept plugging his way through the list, "Now concerning." Now, we are still arguing over some of those issues. If we were to write our own letter to Paul, naming our top 10 issues, what would we write? We quarrel over interpretation of scripture, styles of worship and music, social justice commitments, just to name a few. But the humdinger, the number one issue that divides congregations, is when the manifestation of Christ's presence in the world causes one group of believers to consider themselves better than, more holy than, more saved than the others. Apparently, the Christians in Corinth who spoke in tongues considered themselves the spiritual elite. It takes Paul 3 chapters to deal with this problem. "Now, about the gifts of the Spirit, brothers and sisters, I don't want you to be uninformed." Now, Paul sets out the purpose of his letter in chapter 1. "I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree with one another in what you say, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly united in mind and thought." That longing for unity in the church undergirds his teaching in chapter 12. Paul tells the church that the same Holy Spirit that enabled you to believe in the Lord Jesus has given each and every one of you the gifts you need for the ministry that God desires. One source, but a multitude of gifts, ministries, and activities. Let's take a closer look at that text. The emphasis on unity comes in 3 parallel verses. There are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit distributes them. There are different kinds of service, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of working, but in all of them and in everyone, it is the same God at work. There is one source for our gifts, services, and activities, God. But just as there is a diversity within the Godhead, Spirit, Lord, God, there is a diversity in the gifts that we are given. We are gifted. So much for a spiritual elite. How can you boast about something you were given? It is not something you achieved. There is no merit involved. No, by God's grace, you have been given gifts that will enable us to serve God and God's good purposes. This is not a cause for pride or division. It's a cause for rejoicing in our generous God. Now, this is not the only list of the gifts of the Spirit in the Scriptures. There are more named later in the chapter. There is another list in Romans and also in Ephesians. All told, there are at least 20 gifts of the Spirit, and even that is not an exhaustive list. Here, some of the gifts overlap. How do we differentiate between healing and the working of miracles? Paul makes a list that begins and ends with the gifts most valued by the Corinthians. It begins with wisdom and knowledge. It ends with tongues and the interpretation of tongues. And in between, he cites many gifts, including the one that he most valued, prophecy. So rather than categorize these gifts, it is more helpful to read this list as illustrations of the manifestations of the Holy Spirit. So where do you see the Holy Spirit working in our congregation? What are the gifts that you see among us? Now, sometimes we have trouble identifying our own gifts. I'm thinking of a woman in another Presbyterian church. If you asked her, she would have said she didn't have any gifts. But her gifts were obvious to anyone who knew her. Marge had the gift of hospitality in spades. Any first-time visitor to the congregation went home with a loaf of freshly baked bread. She knew how to welcome people. What about the gift of administration? The gift of administration is more than just pushing paper. People with that gift are able to move a project from planning to completion. They are attentive to detail, and somehow, amid a whole mass of information, they never seem to drop the ball. Will Willimon writes about Mary, who was a woman whose health confined her to a chair, but whose heart roamed free. Mary's gift was writing letters. She would write letters of condolence, but beyond that, she would also write letters of celebration. Whenever she heard good news with someone in the church, whether it was a teenager who got accepted to college or a promotion or a new baby, Mary would write a letter. She was never threatened by the success of someone else. Achievements were a cause for celebration. Who are the peacemakers? After a contentious meeting, who are the ones who phone and just touch base and say, you know, it's okay that we disagree, but we must keep talking with each other? Among us here today, there are so many gifts. People with the gift of teaching and leading, of generosity, of compassion, of service, of prayer, of encouragement and evangelism. To list these gifts is just a beginning place. Part of our role as members of this community of faith is to help each other recognize where God is working through us. You may not see your gift, but someone here does. Let me be very direct. The Holy Spirit has given you gifts. Yes, you. We can work together to find out what these gifts are, and then how you can use them for the common good. For that is how Paul sees these gifts. He summarizes his opening sentences in verse 7. Now to each one the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. We are gifted, not just for the sake of Christians, but for the good of all people. We know that God longs for all humans, all creatures, all creation to flourish. We are partners with God, using our gifts to accomplish God's good, loving, and sovereign purposes for every one and thing God creates. Now, this past summer, we spent many Sundays considering the mission of God and the mission of God's people. I was working with a book by Christopher Wright. We got about halfway through it. There is still a lot more we can say about who we are and what we're about. I trust that those weeks gave us an inkling of the breadth of God's love and therefore the breadth of our mission. Where do we start? We start with our gifts. You see, collectively, our gifts, the gifts given to us by God, have shaped our congregation. Every congregation is a compilation of the unique gifts it has been given for the ministry and mission that God desires. That's why congregations are both the same. We all love and serve the Lord Jesus Christ, but also different, gifted in many ways by the same God. This is part of the reason why every congregation has distinctive values and culture. We are shaped by the gifts that God has given us, and God will use those gifts. God will use us for the common good of the world. Where do we start? Let's start by thinking in terms of the gifts that God has given us. Look around this sanctuary. Who is here? And what do you celebrate about them? Ask yourself some questions. What does your faith mean to you? What does this congregation mean to you? Over the next few months, we will have many opportunities to talk about these things. We will have conversations that will help us appreciate the gifts that God has given us. And as we celebrate God's faithfulness to us, God will show us the next faithful steps in serving the common good. We are a beautiful kaleidoscope, gifted in so many ways by our generous God for the sake of the world God loves. Thanks be to God. Our hymn is "We Have This Ministry." Let's pray together. God of all times and all people, on this Labor Day weekend, we thank you for all the skill and talent with which you bless your people. Thank you for what we have accomplished through the work we do, and for what each one of us contributes to the well-being of our community. Inspire us to work together on the challenges we face, and surprise us with the solutions that to problems that once seemed overwhelming. Today we pray for all those who labor in difficult situations, for children who work in terrible conditions and are paid very little, for migrant workers who must labor far away from their families, and for all those who are underpaid or unjustly treated in their workplace. We pray for those who cannot labor, for those who are unemployed or underemployed, for those who have become injured on the job or too sick to keep working, for those who are denied the opportunity to earn a living because of war or discrimination. We pray for those who labor in our community, for those who must work today and tomorrow instead of enjoying this long weekend, for those who must work several jobs in order to care for their families, and for those who work at jobs we wouldn't do ourselves because they are messy or unpleasant. And on this Labor Day, O God, we offer gratitude for laws that protect children, for health and safety practices that prevent tragedies in the workplace, and for generations before us who advocated for vulnerable employees, fair wages, and equal opportunities. Thank you for the work that goes on behind the scenes, delivering things we enjoy and services we rely on. Help us to look beyond these things to picture the faces of those whose work provides for all our needs. Through their faces, let us see your face, creator and sustainer of all that is. And now, O Lord, we offer to you in the silence of our hearts our prayers for those whose needs are known to us. All this we ask in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's stand and sing to God's praise. O breath of life, come sweeping through us. Let's stand and sing together.
With life and power. Oh, breath of life, come cleanse me.
You are gifted. Go out to serve the Lord, trusting always in the power of the Holy Spirit working among you. And the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit rest upon each one of you, now and forevermore. Amen.
When you walk from here.